sticks in between the rubber plant, which is very helpful also to the soil because it has a lot of nitrogen in the Gillicillia plants. We can have 4 million Gillicillia plants there. That will give enough sticks for burning of firewood to run a bioelectrical plant producing 1 megawatt of electricity. So we can sell this to the government at a very stable long-term price. That can be the carrot for investors, that regardless what happened to the commodity market, we also have other markets we can benefit from. We can also plant pepper vines or even other vines with the Gillicillia sticks. In theory, we could have 4 million pepper vines. A pepper vine gives 2 kilo of pepper a year, 2 harvests. Even if we say half of that will be harvested, there's 4 million kilo of pepper. Problem is, how can we sell that much of pepper in the world? It's the largest pepper production in the world. Crazy. But that is a possibility. Pepper prices are still high. We get 300 rupees per kilo from the market. So it can be a money spinner better than with rubber. But all these things have been now linked up, and we are going ahead with that. They have a meeting next week with the finance ministry in Norway. They have indicated the interest to buy the quota, the CO2. They already bought one from a forest project in Africa. And it is not easy to sell forest quotas because it is a lot of doubt about how you work it out and so on. Therefore, we have been extremely careful. We have had 5 PhD researchers to work for us on the quota system, and we have got also help from experts in India and in Malaysia on rubber, and I think we have a watertight proposal now with them. They paid $7 per ton for the African project. We will, with the Gillicillia and other things, be able to generate around 5 million tons there. If we can sell the 5 million tons for $7 a ton, we have $35 million. That's more than we need to develop the whole thing. If we, in addition, can benefit from electricity, sale of rubber or other things, that will be the bonus. So I think we have now developed a very strong proposal. Well planned, well conceived, in line with the new economic realities as it is. And the ministry will not buy it outright because we need to get it confirmed by the UN. First, that will take a little time because when we get the land, we have to demarcate it. We have to do a lot of research also in the land where we are going to do. But by February, March next year, I think we will be able to have everything ready for the UN. And by September next year, hopefully, we can start the real planting of the area. But it has taken 1 year longer than we proposed in the beginning, and shows this is more complicated than we thought of when we started. But this is a pilot project. We are a pioneering group, so we have to learn while we do things. But we have done quite a lot of work. We have a very good staff, and we are quite hopeful that with a new concept and with some support from the Minister of Finance in Norway, we will be able to do it. And the good thing is that the finance crisis has created the more space for social responsible investment and green investment. Mm. So that is at least some positive thing happening in the world to our favor. That is in brief about the Sri Lanka project. Any question? Ray?
Yes. And Arnie, I love what you brought forward with the commodities. You do expect that, you know, after things with the oil and the prices restabilize, you do expect the price for rubber to rebound, do you not? And some of those other commodities that are now, just like oil and the rest of them, rather deflated, do you expect it to recover?
Yeah, definitely, because the rubber price have always been linked to oil. And we know that the dipping of oil is just temporarily. There is a shortage of oil in the long run. So, and we will not start harvesting for the next 6 years, so we're not that worried about the price now. But for investors, I think they will take all this into consideration. But of course, now with less planting of rubber, the price will even be better in 6 years' time, because we will there will be less new rubber planted. And you know that the rubber tree can only last for 30 years, so a lot of the old rubber plantations will be gone in 6 years' time. So probably less rubber will come to the market and we start tapping. So it's in the long run good for us, I think. And you know also that the tire industry needs 60% of the rubber has to be natural rubber. So I think it is a market there, and with smaller cars, with the cheaper cars, and with environmental friendly cars using less fuel, they still need 4 wheels with tires. So I think whatever happened to the oil industry, I think rubber will be better in the future than it is today. And in our budget, we estimated to tap 1,500 kilo rubber per hectare. Now, we know that with the new type of plants we put in, we may be able to get 2,500, even 3,000 kilo per hectare. So even if the price goes down 60%, if we can increase production by 60% or even more, financially we will be well off anyhow when we come to tapping. So we have some reserves also in that one. So I'm fairly optimistic that we will be able to finance it. And I'm also sure that we will find the good partners to put money in, because this is a sustainable project, long-term project, and it is good for everyone.
Yes, and already the other question that I have is that what I've now, you've got a plan that's going to incorporate bringing energy and using renewable formats. I heard you say biomass. My curiosity is that we could do to some format some type of blend, wind, solar, and other variations of biomass, biofuel there. How, as things develop and as the positive impacts come into the community, what's your vision relative to really bringing that forward for everything from telecommunications to structures, buildings, LED lighting, and things of that nature, because those are things that we hadn't talked about, but clearly through eSolar Tech and some of the things that that group is doing, I have access to bring those things forward, and the parties are very interested in participating in Sri Lanka in that capacity.
Yes, sir, I am looking forward to meet you in 1 or 2 days' time in New York to discuss this further, because my secret dream is, I will reveal it to everyone now, is that get your group in and you can take over the Gillisilia sticks. The plantation will produce the sticks and give them to you, and if you can use these sticks to produce bioenergy, you will get the quotas for the you will get the quota for the energy you produce. That will be quite a lot for 1 megawatt of electricity. And in that region, we have the grid ready. The grid is there with three-phase electricity, so it's easy to send the energy out from the grid. So the infrastructure is there, and the people are willing to work. There is a lot of unemployment there, poor people. It will be a very easy project to do, and the government, as you know, since you went to Sri Lanka earlier this year, will pay 16 American cents per kilowatt hour for this type of green energy, which will give us a very steady income with the contract with the government for the next 10 years.
Well, I'm looking forward to your friendly's arrival, because the group at eSolar Tech and some of the other groups that are associated with them from the University of Thailand and from Middle East Technology School in Mose in Kenya, they have things that are being deployed right now, even LED lighting. We're doing a project right now in South Africa for powering cell towers and also delivery of internet using solar, a mixture of solar and wind for generation. Off-grid. So there are a lot of things that we can do, but again, not wanting to outstretch what is going to be useful and going to be not disruptive for the indigenous populace. So that, to me, is something we need to make sure we marry and, you know, we listen real hard. So I'm looking forward to you guys being here.
Yeah, fine. Our secret plan is to hope we can trap you into this, Ray, and get you involved.
Can I just make a few points? I don't want to hold up to, I know we're moving on the agenda. There's a few points I just wanted to make. One is that the current price of rubber shouldn't impact the ability of investors to put money there, because they will look long term.
I hope so.
And they will understand that. And in fact, it could be an easier environment to raise capital. Mm-hmm. The problem is the availability of money.
Yeah.
And I would suggest that sustainable funds, particularly sustainable pension funds,
mm-hmm.
could be interested in that, particularly once we get past the process of getting UN accreditation.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'd be happy to be involved in some of that.
Fine.
From
here. You have the job. You have the job, Tom.
Well, that wasn't quite what I was looking for.
You are. and you will regret it.
Well, with sufficient trepidation for us, my second question.
Yeah.
I was just wondering who the consultants are who are preparing the brief for the UN, and I'd be interested in looking through the documents. I don't necessarily want
for
the
sure
job,
we will do.
But I'd be interested just
they are, it. The name is Environmental Management Limited.
Okay.
It is a group of partly retired scientists and also government, like the chairman, the former director of the rubber research and so on.
So it's a Sri Lankan based.
Sri Lankan based,
yeah.
Yes. And we pay only 500,000 rupees for that. To do the whole thing for us, which is a fraction of the price we would have had to pay if we had people with the same background from abroad.
Sure.
So we have been very lucky to get them in. But they are slow. That is what I'm a little bit worried for, and I have pulled them up several times. And the man who was working out the credits, he got sick. He had some problem with the eyes and all kind of excuses. But we have been very tough with the leadership there and say we can't tolerate. We have an agreement with an institution, not with the person. So they have put new people on the job, and now we are moving forward.
Okay. Great.
And in keeping with what was said earlier, I can tell you that here in the States, the only place that money is going to is for renewable initiatives. Mm-hmm. And there are a number of investment groups that now actually consolidated advisors that are definitely have interest in this, and they definitely have interest in this relative to Sri Lanka. So we will talk about that when I get here right shortly.
Yeah, that's great. I'm very happy to hear that, Ray. So looking very much forward to meet you, and I think we together can put the missing links into the project and move ahead with full speed.
Yes.
No more questions on Sri Lanka. We will then go to the Ghana project, India and Ghana. That is with Bremley.
Okay, I think we are full house now. Bertrand just arrived, and Tom arrived late, but I think this is the opportunity to just quickly introduce ourselves around the table. Why don't you guys who are virtually present go quickly and just introduce yourself and where you are right now, because this is connecting across three other countries. So why don't you start with Ray, then Tor, then Mahesh, and then we'll go around the group before I make the presentation.